So we are here in the Rare Book Room with Christine. What do you do here in the library?
I am the museum librarian and head of library collections here at the Field Museum.
We are in a particular room in the library. This isn't what the rest of the library looks like.
So we are in the Mary W. Runnells Rare Book Room, and this is about 7,500 volumes of rare materials that are most easily described as the history of natural history and early travels and voyages about natural history.
So these aren't just like the oldest books that you have in the collection.
Exactly. So people often think that rare books are all old. And they're not necessarily. There are several different criteria that make up rare books. So something could be a particularly important association copy, have a very important first owner, it could have high market value, or there could be very limited numbers of a particular work that were ever created.
And you pulled some of these things that we can go look at today.
Yes, I did.
I'm super excited.
Cool.
Let's go. Christine, so what makes this rare book rare?
So one of those other criteria that makes a material rare is when it's something that is completely unique. So something maybe like a handwritten manuscript. In this instance, these are actually original pattern and proof plates that were part of this book that was published in 1887 called American Medicinal Plants. And this was done by Charles Millspaugh, who was an early curator in the Department of Botany here at the Field Museum. And all of these went into the final work that you see here, which is multiple part work.
So this is the original painting that he sat down and did by hand, and this is the plate reproduction of that thing.
Yes, and sometimes with these, there are multiple versions of these within this particular volume. So the final version may have ended up in the book, but there may have been an earlier copy inside of here.
But it's only, this is the only place you could see this
exactly,
particular work.
Exactly.
So that's one criterion, just how old it is can also be criterion alone for being in the rare book room.
Right, so for that, 1801 is oftentimes a cutoff, so anything published prior to 1801 is often considered rare and would be inside of a room like this.
And you have a book that's older than
1801. Yes, I do. So this is actually from 1554. It was created by a man named Ippolito Salviani, and this is one of the earliest books in natural history, filled with species descriptions of fish from the Mediterranean region. Wow. And what's interesting about this is it's one of the first books where the illustrations were done by copperplate engraving, where woodcuts were very popular at the time, and this really makes these images pop out at the users.
And so is this something that somebody could see online?
Yes, you can actually see this online, but what we've discovered over the years is that seeing them online oftentimes sparks people to want to see them in person.
So they might not necessarily be like an ichthyologist studying fish, curious about the fish in the Mediterranean from the 1500s, but they might want to know about the artist
exactly
who did the engraving.
So this is a book called The Investigations and Studies in Jade. So it is filled with all of these lovely images of jade objects, ornaments, jewelry, things like that. And this is number 96 of only 100 that were ever created.
Wow.
So this was actually published in 1906. The jade collection itself is at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. But then they created two volumes. This is only one of the volumes that has all of these lovely images in it. And what's also pretty interesting about this is once they published these books, they destroyed the plates that they used to make this book so that they could never make any more of them.
Wow, that's amazing. But also like a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, please, I know.
Yes.
Well, it's beautiful.
It is.
Is there like a functional reason it has to be this big? Or was it just because they wanted to make a point?
They could be, or you want to show the objects in their original size, things like that.
I see.
They really pop out that way.
Wow, that's a cool book.
So this is Charles Darwin's Origin of Species. So this is arguably one of the most important texts in the history of natural history.
So what makes this copy more rare than the copy that I got that was printed like in the 80s?
So this is a first edition from 1859. Good way to tell that you have a first edition. is that if you go to page 20 of the book, you'll see right here that the word species is misspelled, is one of the indicators.
Do you know how many copies were issued in the first edition?
So there were about 1,250 that were originally issued. This has actually been documented as part of the Darwin Census Project, which was out of Cambridge University and the Huntington Library. So we actually have two copies of this work, and both of them are documented in the census.
Well, that's amazing. Yes. Oh, I didn't know that they did the census on books like they did a census on people.
Yes, they do.
Well, I guess if you're Darwin. The final book that we're going to talk about isn't just special in one unique way.
Yeah, it's special in several different ways. It hits several different criteria. One, its size. This is a double elephant folio of John James Audubon's Birds of America. So this is our volume 2. The other aspect of this is that this is filled with hand-colored illustrations, and this also does have a high market value. So this is a 12-year publishing enterprise that started in 1826 and then continued over that span of time. If people wanted to own these particular volumes, they would subscribe to them, and what they would receive in the mail would be 5 plates. Then when they had what would be considered to be a complete volume, they would take it to a bookbinder who would put it together into one particular volume. So a complete set is 4 volumes. We do have all 4 volumes of it. Where our volume is even more special is that our set has what are called composite plates, and it has all 13 of those composite plates. That means that, again, over this 12-year publishing enterprise, there may have been particular bird species that were misidentified or some other reason that they may have been put together sort of with unassociated species. So, for example, so we have this particular plate of the Louisiana tanager and the scarlet tanager, and you have these 4 birds right here. And then on the very next plate, which is the composite, so this particular species was previously on a different plate, and then he realized later on that he really belonged in this grouping of birds, so that he was added on later.
So they were like, oh shoot, I can't just like open up the digital project file and Photoshop that thing in. I gotta like repress the whole thing.
Exactly.
So how did we end up with one of the most unique, complete copies of the Birds of America?
It was actually purchased at auction on our behalf in 1969 and then donated to the institution. And that's how the room is now named the Mary W. Runnells Rare Book Room, because it was through the generosity of her that we have this beautiful set.
And why does this book need to be as big as it is?
Because Audubon wanted to have these illustrations in the life size of all of the species.
So if you had like a scarlet tanager, which you wouldn't have, a dead one, but you held it up, it would,
yes,
it'd match. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't recommend doing that. So now that we've seen some of the books that you pulled, if somebody were interested in looking at some of those materials, where could they go?
So yes, we have been working very hard over the last 10 years through our partnership with the Biodiversity Heritage Library to digitize the contents of this room. We are at over 50 million pages of digitized literature that we are making freely available on the web.
I love it. I use the Biodiversity Heritage Library all the time when I'm looking up, even if it's like old museum bulletins or like beautiful illustrations for videos that we've made, or like I read this account about freshwater bivalves in the button industry from 1908. Don't know how I would have found that anywhere else.
Yeah, it's an awesome resource.
I love it so much. So you should go check it out. Well, thank you so much for taking the time today.
You're welcome.
It still has brains on it.